Some people might argue that almost everyone has some kind of ideological structure in the way that they view the world. If your ideology is gearing you toward or propelling you towards the truth, clearly those ideologies are going to be better than others that are exclusionary, harmful, causing division and racism and, you know, all this insane. Their ultimate goal seems to me to find these oppressor versus oppressed classes and pit them against each other. We certainly have a crisis of meaning, of significance, of what would give you a higher sense of purpose.
Christians are in a minority now.
More people than ever have described themselves as having no religion.
So that's why I make these films, is to get people moving in a better direction.
For the wrong to rule, the good must just stand idly by.
Hiya, how you doing? This week, I'm very lucky to be joined by Travis Brown from wokeformation.com. He's a documentary filmmaker and he's just got back from Ireland where he was covering the Gen Spect conference. But we'll get onto that, about gender ideology and the madness that is consuming the world. But first of all, Travis, thank you so much for joining me. Can you tell the audience a bit about yourself?
Sure, yeah. Thank you for having me. I really appreciate it. So I'm a documentary filmmaker. I've been a filmmaker since about 2009. And what really interested me in covering ideology and what interested me in philosophy was growing up in a fundamentalist Christian home and being really indoctrinated into that ideology and then leaving it behind and then seeing how different ideologies use the same kind of mindsets where, you know, I moved to Seattle and then Portland, Oregon, and I thought that these places would be these kind of like liberal bastions of freedom and free speech and that sort of thing. And then I started to notice the same kinds of black and white, dichotomous thinking. Anyone who doesn't agree with us is evil, you know, does just demonize everyone who doesn't agree with our set of beliefs. So that really just interested me, and I wanted to start filming and capturing just this phenomenon of wokeness. You know, back in, I would say, like 2013, 2014, we wouldn't have called it that then, but just seeing the kind of craziness unfold in the streets of Portland, and having that get worse and worse with Trump's election and then in 2020, that just sparked my interest in covering woke topics and trying to understand what the hell was going on.
Do you think there are, because obviously I grew up in a Christian household as well, and whether you want to shrug those values off, it's kind of difficult, isn't it? Because they sort of become ingrained in you. But do you think there are some ideologies are better than others?
Sure, yeah. I mean, you know, some people might argue that almost everyone has some kind of ideological structure in the way that they view the world. And if your ideology is gearing you toward or propelling you towards the truth, and if that's one of your penultimate goals, and compassion and all of these other things, if that's informing one's ideology, then clearly those ideologies are going to be better than others that are exclusionary, harmful, causing things like, you know, division and racism and, you know, all this insane shit that we see with gender ideology. So certainly.
So would you say that wokeness, what's the ideological goal of wokeness?
What is the ideological goal of wokeness? Yeah, it's
hard. It's an equity cult, isn't it, in a way? It's an equity cult, isn't it?
It is. I mean, it seems to have these neo-Marxist underpinnings that their ultimate goal seems to me to find these oppressor versus oppressed classes and pit them against each other, really to dismantle and destroy capitalism. I mean, you see that, and whether we're talking about, you know, environmental justice or even things like, you know, homophobia or transphobia or race, there's often in the literature and then in what people say, their ultimate goal is to dismantle capitalism and to dismantle the structures, the liberalism, really, that we have. So that seems to me to be one of the primary goals. It really does seem to be underpinned by neo-Marxist and post-structuralist ideas.
Yeah, and it's sort of everywhere now. And as you said, 2013, 2014, you wouldn't have called it wokeness. It would have had a different name. And Louis Theroux used to make documentaries. He did Portland very early on, didn't he? Mm. And he was talking about polyamory and stuff like this.
Okay.
And my fear about this stuff is that it, by sort of allowing peculiar tropes like chopping the dicks off children is affirming them in some way, by allowing these very chaotic systems to to function in society, that that's massively destabilizing, not just to capitalism, but to civilization in general. Do you think that's a fair assessment, or am I being hyperbolic?
No, I think that is a fair assessment. I mean, when you can't describe what a man or woman is, and you see this, I don't know if you see it in Parliament, but you certainly see it in the United States, where people, you know, in Congress cannot say, they say, oh, I'm not a biologist, Supreme Court, yeah. They say, I'm not a biologist, therefore I can't tell you what a man and woman is. I mean, that is extremely destabilizing. It's destabilizing to just how we talk and how medicine functions, how the family unit functions, and more, so.
So in terms of family unit, we have, you know, religious structures have been in place for forever,
right.
You know, essentially, and one can argue whether with people who have faith, whether they're right or wrong or whatever. But the thing is, that seemed, obviously it created conflicts and division as well, but it didn't seem to be so infectious as this wokeness is you know, it didn't seem, people would resist. And also atheism was tolerated, you know, and it has been tolerated a lot.
Yeah.
But anti-wokeness is not tolerated at all, is it?
No, not within the circles of anyone who's woke or woke adjacent or woke sympathetic. It seems anyone who goes against the narrative is excluded or their opinions are demonized. Whereas, yeah, in many faith traditions, you can agree to disagree or you can hash it out. And so sometimes, you know, even though I'm not religious myself, I sometimes do lament the decline of traditional religion because there was something more inherently stable about its more current incarnation.
And do you think wokeness is religion itself to replace traditional religion?
I mean, I think it is. I've certainly talked about that in my series. Other people like to say specifically that it's a cult. Sometimes distinguishing between those two things is a little challenging. But yeah, it's certainly a cultish religion for sure.
If I had to say, if I said to you, right, just what, because it's really hard, and it's also what happens whenever you go on TV or something like that, someone goes, well, what is woke? I thought woke was being awake to problems and trying to make more equality in the world. That would be the defense of woke.
Yeah.
What is it, really?
Yeah, so originally it did start in black culture to essentially mean to be awakened to injustice that maybe not everyone is aware of or seeing in their daily lives. And yeah, I think that's a good thing. I think it's good to be aware of, you know, things going wrong and you know, injustices occurring. I think that's great and fine. What it seems to have morphed into, like you were showing me a clip earlier off camera, where people now get away with saying that basically anything can be an injustice. And so it's spread so far and so fast, and it includes so many of these, you know, microaggressions and these minor infractions of what people think are wrong. And so therefore that becomes the injustice. Like, if you don't reshape society to include all fat people or, you know, all obese people, or if you don't reshape society to, you know, make equity, make all, you know, all outcomes be the same for blacks and whites in every corner of society, then that is an injustice. When we know that life is just more complex than that, right?
Dear white people, I don't even know where to start. In between my busy schedule comprised entirely of surviving white America, there is simply no time to write letters. Besides, any letter I write will most likely bring tears to your eyes, and I, for one, have had my fill of white tears. There are days I think you aren't worth my ink, that your whiteness is draining me of too much energy. Can't give you a taste of the tea for fear you'll colonize the whole kitchen. But today, I am too angry to remain silent. Dear white people, stop making everything about you and how uncomfortable you are. I honestly don't give a flying fuck about your comfort level. You have made my very existence an exercise in discomfort. It is time for you to make room at the table. Better yet, go sit in the living room. I am not here to coddle your feelings, not here for your amusement. No, you cannot touch my hair. This isn't a damn petting zoo. And stop coming into my office asking for the managers if you aren't already looking at one. Dear white people, stop telling me about this colorblind society you allegedly live in. Telling me you don't see race is the racist drivel I hope you choke on. Telling me you respect me but don't see my color is like saying you have to pretend I'm not black in order to respect me. But let me assure you, I am black, though there are plenty of things I'm not, like your sassy black friend. Stop saying, hey girl, when you see me. You ain't that slick. I hear the way you talk to Becky and Steve every day. You sound like vacation on Martha's Vineyard where you spent summers waiting in the bitter blue of the Atlantic. How I wish my toes could touch the ocean without stepping on the bones of my ancestors. Dear white teachers, why don't I know who my ancestors are? Why is only one part of my history important enough to teach? And for the love of God, stop swiveling your heads every time slavery is mentioned. Newsflash, I wasn't there. And just because I'm the only black person in this class doesn't mean you can ask me to speak on behalf of my race. I believe you really care about the opinion of black students when you stop shutting down conversations because I call a white student racist. Dear white people, why do you hate being called racist more than you hate racism? Why do you listen to Tim Wise over actual black people about the black experience? Dear white people, stop using black on black crime as a reason we shouldn't be outraged by the murder of black people by white cops. If a black person kills a black person, they will go to jail, and that is what we call justice. If a white cop kills a black person, they will get paid leave, and that is what we call justice. Apparently, justice is when a black body dies. Dear white people, every time we've written white people, we've written it in lowercase because we are tired of you capitalizing on our pain. We are angry and raw and tired and angry and raw and tired and tired and tired, but we will not rest because we know the future belongs to those who prepare for it. And you have been getting us ready for centuries.
So for me, when I saw that video, I was shocked by the open racism of it.
Yeah,
sitting there and blaming everything on white people and all of this stuff. So, and at one point she says, dear white people, stop making everything about you. I then tweeted, dear black people, stop making everything about you, as a rhetorical device to point it out. And I was so shocked by the, not shocked because social media, nothing ever shocked me on social media,
but yeah.
I was really surprised by the lack of nuance, and or whether it's deliberate lack of nuance, whether people are actually genuinely thick on social media, or whether it's a deliberate departing of the nuance. Do you think social media is helping encourage this sort of narcissistic element to wokeness?
For sure, yeah. I mean, social media causes all kinds of problems even outside of wokeness, but yeah, I mean, people can be somewhat anonymous online or entirely anonymous, and so that allows them to be these keyboard warriors just saying anything that they want to say. And so if they latch onto this idea and they feel self-righteous and it boosts their ego, then people are going to do it. And it's certainly made the I mean, these ideas have been in academia for quite a long time, and you can read about them in the 80s and 90s with Kimberly Crenshaw and Judith Butler and all these other people. But it wasn't until social media and the iPhone that these ideas really proliferated very quickly. And then, of course, certain events like COVID and Trump being elected and the riots, like all those things made it just skyrocket in popularity.
Yeah, the George Floyd of this world. But why do you think media in itself, you're a documentary maker, why do you think media deliberately ignores, so, you know, just the standard conservative position of 50% of murders in America are committed by what, I mean, if we're talking about black men, we're talking about 7% of the population. Mm-hmm. That's just ignored. Media never talks about that. But it's very keen on going, you're oppressed, you're oppressed, you're oppressed. But the black people that are killing people, they're killing other black people.
Right.
In the main, you know, interracial shootings and murders are not common, particularly. So why do you think the media like to feed this stuff as well?
Yeah, well, I suppose I like to refer to what Shelby Steele, a black author in the United States.
He's great, Shelby Steele. Read his books.
I love Shelby Steele. He calls this the poetic truth. So it's much like the Michael Brown case, where after that...
hands up, don't shoot, Michael
Brown. Yes, hands up, exactly. So he did not have his hands up and was not saying don't shoot. He was charging the police officer, and we know this. But the poetic truth is that he had his hands up, he was innocent, he wasn't doing anything, and he just got shot. That has a certain narrative, and with the history of racism and slavery in the United States, it fits that narrative. It fits that sort of legacy narrative that... everything's really basically the same. Certain prejudices maybe have gone underground, or you just don't see them very well or very often, but they're there. And, you know, the police is one example of that. So that's, I think, everyone likes a good story. You know, everyone likes a good narrative. And everyone likes clear good guys and bad guys. So if you can just demonize white people or demonize the cops or demonize whomever, then you have a clear bad guy, and then you have someone to fight against, and it gives you your life a structure, a narrative, and a sense of meaning. But I think that's the meaning crisis is a huge part of what plays into this, and I think the media just feeds on that.
Mm. But it seems to me to be quite scary, because you're destabilizing a situation. So there's legitimate conversations to be had about the incarceration of the mass incarceration of black people. There is a really legitimate conversation, but no one has it because we're too busy. You're not getting to the crux of the issue. And if you're going to demonize one portion of society, white people, for historical injustice in slavery, right, and you're trying to remedy that, we've already got the records of what happens when you remedy that. You had 70% of black families, even during Jim Crow, stayed together.
Right.
And now 70% of black families are not together.
Yeah.
And fathers are out the home, and kids without dads, giving them, you know, clipping them around the ear once in a while. It's not a good thing, right? So every time the government has intervened to mm-hmm. try and settle this injustice, it makes it worse.
Right.
So, you know, and you'll never hear very few white people in this country will know who Thomas Sowell is, who Shelby Steele is.
Right.
They just won't know these people. But these are the great thinkers
yeah.
of the world. So is there a conspiracy to keep this poetic lie going, do you think?
Yeah, it's hard to say. I mean, it certainly feels that way at times, doesn't it? I mean, you have people's natural inclinations to want to be on the side of good, and that natural inclination to be kind of self-righteous and show everyone that you're on the right side of history. That phrase gets used all the time. It's very annoying. But then you do have, you know, powerful, rich individuals, like we can talk a little bit about. I don't have a lot of the details, but a lot of the people who are pushing the trans narrative are rich trans women who then, you know, lobby and use their organizations and put a lot of money into changing the language. So that's one example of something somewhat conspiratorial that you can point to.
Let's go on to trans, because I want to talk yeah. about this. You just got back from Ireland.
Yeah.
Tell us about that, what you were doing there, and what was going on.
Yeah, so the wonderful Stella O'Malley was putting on this conference with Genspect, and it took place in Killarney, Ireland's small town. It's quite lovely, but had all the great minds that are talking about this stuff, therapists, pediatricians, you know, journalists, biologists. Everyone was offering kind of an alternative narrative to the you must affirm your child's gender and immediately start puberty blockers and then hormones and then surgery. So these are people who, they don't all agree, but most of them were, you know, pretty strong agreement when it comes to not using the gender affirming model and just showing all the data, frankly, that is now finally coming out about that being very harmful for children, destroying families, ruining single-sex spaces for women, et cetera. So it was a fantastic three-day conference. We filmed that and got several interviews with people like Helen Joyce and Stella and Sasha Ayad, who's a therapist who treats gender dysphoric kids. And so it was an amazing place.
It strikes me. I was saying to you before, I'm okay with people being trans. If you want to be trans, I'm okay with it. I can't change. I still see a man.
Sure.
I do. I just, yeah. And I can't help that. Yeah. What I find more spooky about it is the fact that anyone who points out the truth, as you say, in the pursuit of the truth, which is you are a biological man, whether you want to be called Helen or not,
right,
you're greeted with about as much rage as the world can throw at you. And that seems to be strange. So I get the fact that the world is full of evil people doing evil stuff to each other every single day. But it's the reaction when you point out the truth that I find so shocking. What do you think that's all about?
Yeah, that's a good question. There seems to be a lot of rage in the trans activist movement, even more so than I think some of the Black Lives Matter, you know, rallies and riots and that sort of thing, which is, I think, perhaps the reason for that rage and that vitriol is because the narrative is so batshit crazy that they have to. I mean, there's no way to calmly, logically argue with somebody about this. I mean, there's,
because it's an emotional thing, isn't it?
It is. Yeah.
And but therefore, you know, I do have a faith, so I do believe in God. But mm. I'm like, this seems to take one level beyond. I mean, you know, you saw. I'm sure you saw what Tucker's thing, the last thing Tucker did before he lost his job, and he decided to bring a spiritual element into it and say it was a war between good and evil. Mm-hmm. And it's the only way I can really frame this at the moment, because mutilating children and then calling that affirming healthcare,
right,
to me is satanic. That's what it is. I'm just like, that is where the devil is in life. He loves that sort of thing. So is there another way I can frame it in my own head?
Given that I don't believe in the supernatural, I would just say it's extremely grotesque and evil. I don't usually like to use the word evil, but it's pretty evil.
Yeah.
it's pretty evil. I certainly think it's derailing us from having any kind of normalcy. It's clearly harmful to children as well as young adults. I mean, that's why you have so many people detransitioning now who have said, "Oh, I was duped," or these people pushed me on this fast track to medicalization and then offered me this, you know, non-binary top surgery, for instance, which, what the hell is even that? I mean, it's insane.
It's now I've seen it, I don't know if it's sort of faddish, but you've seen people who are, I mean, it's obviously, this woke thing is going into mental health, isn't it? That's mm-hmm. where, I mean, it stopped off at race. It moved into trans and it's spotted in trans. Started off with Me Too in, you know, the iterations of it. But it, mm. and then it went on to race and it thought, I'm onto a winner. I can divide everybody now.
Yeah.
But then people cottoned on to the fact that didn't work and people wanted just to connect, whether they were of whatever skin color, because the world is infinitely less racist in the West than it ever has been.
For sure.
So now it's gone into the brain and into this sort of mental health thing. And if I feel bad about something, then there's a biological solution to that problem, which is to alter myself to the point where people are putting Drano in their eyes, you know, because they're trans blind. Did you see that woman?
No.
Yeah, she literally got someone to pour bleach in her eyes. Yes. And she said, I always felt like I was blind. So is this a mental health crisis that this is?
Certainly, it's a mental health crisis. I think also what I touched on earlier, that we have this crisis of meaning, perhaps partly because
I wanted to pick up on that. Yes, yeah. Meaning. We have a crisis of meaning. What do you mean?
Yeah, well, we certainly have a crisis of meaning, of significance, of status that religions often would grant people. I mean, you would have your orientation in the world. You knew what was good and what was bad, and you knew what to work toward, what would make you a good person, what would give you a higher sense of purpose. And that, you know, without God is very challenging to come to and to come across and to figure out for yourself. I think it's possible. I think I live a very meaningful life, and it's partly because I'm striving for things that are greater than myself, and I want to connect with people. And so there are all sorts of things that I think feed this crisis of meaning, but one of them, in addition to the decline of traditional religion, is also just being online so much and being disembodied and just on the screen or in the virtual world or playing games, so much so that people have disconnected from their bodies. And so there was, you know, a lot of the therapists I spoke to, I was asking, well, what can we do about this? How can we get kids on the right path? And all of them said, we need to get them back in their bodies, you know, riding horses, doing things outside of just living on their screens, because this contributes so much to that.
It's going to be so hard to do, though, because, you know, look, where I'm an adult and I have zero control over my screen usage.
Yeah.
You know? Like, you see it every time someone's at a restaurant and someone gets up and goes to the bathroom, immediately the phone comes out. It's like people are frightened of being alone with themselves.
Right.
Which I completely understand.
Yeah.
Because I was an actor before I did this, and I would often go and film places and I'd have to eat by myself if I was the only actor filming the next day or something like that. And I'd take a book and I'd feel a bit insecure.
Sure.
So I don't know if there's a way of, I mean, yeah, you can get, I'm lucky, my youngest son loves football, so he's just always playing sports, which is great. But he's still on his screen. Matt Walsh was saying that he thinks that if you have screens on in the house, you're not a family at that time with children. So in the reality, this isn't going to change. It's going to get more screened. People are going to get more and more screeny. You know, it's going to be a jump to try and get them out of it. What is there a healthy way of engaging with screens that you would think? Or what was the feedback from the conference?
Well, the first person that came to my mind is one of the only people that actually talks about this in depth is Tristan Harris. He was an ethicist at Google, and he acknowledges that, you know, we shouldn't be Luddites. We're not going to go backwards in time. We should just find healthier ways to use our phones. And, you know, there are many examples of that. You know, turn off all notifications, only go into the app to check notifications, things like that. Don't use your phone as your alarm clock. All sorts of things to sort of at least reduce our use to some degree. But I think also just remembering the importance of real human connection And then again, like being in your body, that's what a lot of people have talked about. So for me, you know, like I do martial arts, I used to do kung fu, and now I do jujitsu. So I think, you know, or people can go hiking, they can play, you know, tennis, whatever it is. I think the more and more physical activities, also, you know, obesity is such a problem in the United States that I think that would help with that issue as well. But the more that we can physically connect and emotionally connect with other real people, especially now that the COVID restrictions are gone, I think that's one big part of that.
Yeah, but perhaps one of the ways of doing that is to instantiate it in schooling and stuff like
yeah,
that.
For sure.
Because it's, you know, that virtual world isn't reflective of the real world either. But then on the other side, it's really helpful. So I wouldn't have come across Shelby Steele, for example, or Thomas Sowell if I hadn't had access to the internet.
For sure.
And so I don't really know where the balance is. I suppose the other thing that I'm interested in is it feels to me, and maybe it's just because I'm sensitive to it, having had a major pile-on yesterday from these people, but it seems to me that we're goading. So we've got this problem of radically weird topics that everyone has that see as normal, like gender ideology.
Yeah,
it's normal. It's affirming. It's like, no, it's not. And it's not. And then you've got this crazy environmental stuff where it's like it's the end of the world. All of this stuff is debunked. All of it is debunked. And yet people are obsessed with it in their sort of environmentalism is religion. You've got two factions of society that are splitting ever more. You see it in America, you see with the Trump, the MAGA lot, and then the hard left, the woke lot who are running Biden's, you know, who thought Joe Biden was that crazy? Mm-hmm. Probably not, but he's just being told what to do. But it's going apart like this. Mm-hmm. We've got many, many examples of what happens when two tribes separate out. Is there a possibility that this sort of thing can turn into a kind of Hutsi Tutu type vibe? You know, where one tribe just goes, I'm done with you.
Sure, sure. I mean, it's certainly possible. I mean, and in the US, it's more alarming because there are so many guns everywhere. I'm not against...
Is that a good thing, though?
Yeah, I'm not against guns myself. I mean, I have them, but it's just, in terms of the number of deaths that could occur, it may be worse, but it's hard. It's hard to say. You know, I certainly don't want to throw out any predictions, but it certainly can happen. I mean, we see, you know, in the Black Lives Matter riots, people were being murdered in the street.
Yeah, so this one's a Trumpist or something. He said, didn't
yeah,
he?
Yeah,
that was in Portland, wasn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, yeah. Aaron J. Danielson was his name, and he was just part of something called the Patriot Prayer. Just a conservative Christian, not a racist, not a white supremacist. And even my own ex-girlfriend, in fact, was saying, oh, well, you know, that's one for our team. And I'm like,
"You said
what?
That?
Yeah, well, what team are you
no
on?
I wonder she's an ex-girlfriend.
Yeah, it's maddening. So when people like that can make those justifications and then people are literally in the street shooting each other at times, it's certainly concerning, which is why I try to encourage dialogue, because that's, you know, we have dialogue and we have force. So to me, leaning toward the dialogue is...
Can you have dialogue with an arch-wokist?
Well, no. So there are some people, I think, you know, John McWhorter touches on this quite a bit in his book, Woke Racism, which is that the true believers of any cult are people that you're not going to be able to talk with, right? Maybe once in a while you can. I mean, Daryl Davis has done this with KKK members, right? So there are some examples of that happening, but generally speaking, as John McWhorter puts it, you just have to acknowledge that those people exist and get them out of the way and just go on with society and you know, vote for the policies that you want and have the conversations with the people who are willing to have those conversations. But if someone's not willing to, you know, for instance, I was with Peter Boghossian outside of Portland State, and I suggested that we were playing this game where we ask people questions, and it was all...
They take a step forward, step back.
Yes, exactly, yeah. And so I had him put, or suggested that we put, there are only two genders on the whiteboard. And this was a public space. We were free to be filming there and everything. And then they started screaming at us and flipping us off from the rooftop and telling us to leave and that we were causing harm. And here we are just, you know, engaging in conversation. And then they came down and mobbed us, and it ended up being about 19 people, you know, preaching to us about just how harmful we are and just how, you know, these trans students had to go home because they were so unsafe. And I was just thinking that was amazing. The words on a board caused people to feel so endangered for their lives that they decided to leave.
But that's terrifying, right? So
yeah.
I would classify myself, the internet would call me a far-right Nazi, white supremacist, fascist pig, But I categorize myself as fairly liberal. Mm-hmm. I lean conservative on certain things because of my religion, but that's fine. But I lean quite liberal on some things.
Yeah.
But I am, to them, I'm Hitler.
Right. Right.
You know, so if and I'm willing to talk to anybody, but if you can't speak to me about something, then
right.
And that's the majority of them as well, and they get a look in their eye as well. Like I've you know, everyone gets in trouble. Who got Tucker again? He got in trouble of saying they're talking about what they call the Great Replacement theory. Mm. I've interviewed people who have told me from their horse's mouth. They've said the British Empire colonized these countries, therefore it's revenge.
Hmm.
They've said it's come out of their own mouth.
Yeah.
So I'm going, well, that sounds to me like a replacement, doesn't it?
Hmm.
You're coming, but then you say that, and it's like, no, you're a racist Nazi. And I'm like,
right.
How do you engage with these people? I mean, is it going to, but what I want to know is, will it burn out?
That's what I'm hoping. I mean, I make these films because I don't see it burning out quickly enough. And I hope to help explain to people, you know, living in Portland, most of my friends are quite liberal. I happily call myself politically homeless. I don't really align with either side too well. But one of my main goals with my series is to help people who are maybe woke adjacent or whatever word you want to use, who are sympathetic to some of these ideas, and help walk them through the process of realizing that
detransitioning.
There's detransitioning. I mean, there are all these reasons to realize that what's being pushed for with wokeness is so harmful and divisive and toxic that we have to wake up to this and realize how terrible it is. But you will find those people who are the true believers who you can't really talk to. And I think, you know, filming those experiences, putting them online and having people see them, I think is helpful. I think also it's good to remember that those true believers are something like, 8% or something of the population. Like, it's a small percentage of the population. And unfortunately, they have a loud voice and they're activists, so they're trying to make policy and everything, but I think the more we can help people realize what's going on, the more everyday people who don't believe in this shit can then come out to vote and, you know, push for better schools and all the things that we can do. So that's why I make these films, is to get people moving in the better direction.
I think it's really good, and I think that's the most important thing. I also think that when I look at policy, I don't think any of these policies have been voted for. I don't think anybody voted to mutilate children. I don't think anybody voted for net zero. I don't think anyone voted for COVID lockdowns. I mean, I think a percentage of people would have supported them and still do. I don't think anyone would voted for mandatory vaccinations to work in a care home. I just don't think these policies are voted for. I think they're decided by this activist 8% who spend their every waking hour doing that, lobbying for change.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. I think Helen Joyce talks about this in her book, Trans, that... you know, we often civil rights movements have gained acceptance and proliferated because they were broad-based coalition movements. And they're trying to get everyone on board to see them as human. Whereas with the radical trans activists, it's very surreptitious, and people are going behind the scenes and, you know, using whatever funding and all of their activism that they can to just ram these things through.
Yeah.
And so that is concerning. But the only thing I can do is to, you know, as a citizen, is try to help people understand what's going on and be like, wait a minute, you know, I'm not going to send my kid to that school, or I'm going to do something different. That's all I can really do.
Do you think schools are where, because obviously this is, you know, in England we talk about the long march through the institutions and the fact that each institution has been captured. And, you know, conservatives would say that we need our institutions because they prop up and support our society. So if this has been a long march through the institutions to get to the point where basically children can read pornography in schools and Chelsea Clinton thinks it's a good idea and it's a bad idea that they're banned from reading pornography in schools, do you think that's where we should start in education?
I do, yeah. It's in the United States, at least, it's such a behemoth. It's very challenging. I'm not an expert in education by any stretch of the imagination, but that would be the ideal, is changing some of these structures and some of the instruction in education to you know, ferret some of this stuff out and just get back to, I mean, that's the insane thing. It started with the race thing, you know. Math is racist, science is racist, and everyone pushing that stuff through, whereas they're no longer teaching, you know, math and geography and all these things that matter. It's all infused with social justice nonsense. And that is because of this long march through the institutions. I did a series with Lyle Asher, and he talked about the colleges of education being captured by this sort of socialist, very far left ideology. And then those are training our teachers to teach our kids. And so it's a massive problem. It's hard to know where to begin.
It really is. I quite like that French thing. It works in practice, but does it work in theory?
Yeah.
What's happening in universities, because they're protected, they're behind their walls, aren't they? You can spout all the far leftist ideological stuff you think that the world would work in theory, but it really doesn't work in practice. Travis, thank you so much for talking to me. Can you tell people where they can find you?
Yeah, so I have a Locals, so if people want to support my work on there, they can. It's travisbrown.locals.com, and then YouTube as well, which is, what is it? I think it's at Become the Signal. But if you go to wokereformation.com, you can find everything. So
go to wokereformation.com. Travis Brown, thank you so much.
Thank you. I really appreciate it.
My pleasure.